All right, so today we're going to start our official notes for Unit 3, our very first notes on Thermochem. The pretest you guys took a couple of days ago, which wasn't for a grade, although it was amusing for some of your answers. You're like, I have no idea, which is fine. I haven't talked to you yet. Some of the questions on the pretest will be things that you can answer by the end of today, especially the iceberg question, what had more heat. The giant iceberg, that was 100,000 liters, or the single liter of hot water, like a cup of hot tea or something like that. Although that'd be a really big cup of hot tea. But some of these questions you'll be able to start to answer. Tomorrow we're going to have a lab where we put concrete hands-on experience to pair up with the notes that we're taking today. So, without further ado, we're going to talk about thermal energy, temperature, and heat notes. You'll also start to notice that there is quite a lot of drawing potentially in this unit, and you will see just how very, very awful my best artistic work can be. It's great, like that's why he's a chemistry teacher and not a science and not an art teacher. That makes a lot of sense. And especially for those of you guys who are spatial or visual learners, there's some of these problems you might really enjoy to be like, oh yeah, alright, I can kind of picture it, I can draw it out for you. It's a little hard for me to explain in words sometimes, but so let's talk. Kinetic energy, energy of a moving object. It's got to be moving. Got to be moving. I think that this is something you guys have learned before, at least a couple of times when we talk about kinetic energy. So kinetic energy is the energy of a moving object. Now where will we see that? What's moving in any object? The particles. The particles in every object are always, always, always moving. All of the time. In other words, every single object that you can possibly think of has kinetic energy, whether it looks like it's moving or not, because the particles that make up that object are always in motion, 100% of the time. So everything's got kinetic energy. The faster something's moving, the more energy it's got. And so sometimes I'll draw a picture like this where I got a bunch of little particles. And so this little fella in the corner, who's just barely moving, he has low kinetic energy. This guy's like, yeah, going super fast. That's a lot of kinetic energy. So the faster something's moving, the more kinetic energy it has. Now, thermal energy is the total kinetic energy of the particles in a substance. So you take the kinetic energy of this particle, add it to the kinetic energy of this particle, and that one, 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 and all the billions and billions and billions and billions and billions of particles in any given substance. Yes, I said billions with a B. And that's a gross underestimation. It's more like trillions times trillions times trillions. But the point is, you take the kinetic energy of every single particle, you add all of those up. So every particle counts. And that is what thermal energy is. The units for thermal energy will be the joule. Joule, J-O-U-L-E. And that is a capital J, not a lowercase j. That is a capital J as the symbol in parentheses. You'll be seeing a capital J all the time in this unit. Throw some J's on that energy. Right? Sweet. Anyways, this means thermal energy is extensive. Why does that make sense? Why does that make sense? Thermal energy is extensive. It depends on how much stuff you have. Why is that? How does that line up based on the whole idea with particles, etc.? Somebody explain this to me. Packet?
Well, if it's adding up the total kinetic energy of all the particles, there's more to add up, meaning it's more.
Right, yeah, there you go. So if you're adding up the energy of all the particles, every time you add particles or take away particles, the amount of total kinetic energy, aka thermal energy, will change. So it does depend on how much stuff you have. So thermal energy is extensive. Because if you take, like, no matter how much water I have, if I pour a team of it out, I just lost thermal energy. If I add a little bit, I just gain thermal energy. That's how that works. So mass does count for thermal energy. Mass does count. It counts. Oh, yes, indeedy. And so that will bring us to that iceberg question from the pretest the other day. So the question was, What has more energy? The iceberg, that's giant, but it's got a relatively low temperature, or the cup of hot water, that's tiny, but has a relatively high temperature. So that one's high temp, low temp. Well, it turns out that this iceberg definitely has way, 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 way more energy. It's got way more energy. Way more. Because even though it's at a little bit lower temperature, you add up the mass of all those particles. I think in the question, the iceberg was 100,000 liters, whereas the little cup of hot water was just 1 liter. So it has 100,000 times more particles to add the energy up of, and that's going to overcome the fact that it's a slightly lower temperature. Yep. Now, if we were to take like a little ice cube, let's say this ice cube right here is about 1 liter as well. So let's say it has the same mass as the hot tea water. So the mass is the same now, but the temp is a little bit lower. So then this is where the hot cup of water, that would actually win out. Okay, so that would have more thermal energy if the mass is the same and the temperatures are the only difference. But when you have a gargantuan difference in mass like that, whichever one has higher mass, that's going to be the one that has more thermal energy. You just have so many more particles and their kinetic energies, you add them all up, and boom, more thermal energy. So there you go. How many people said the iceberg has more just because you guessed and you had no clue? You're like, oh, I don't know. Lucky you. Look at that. Nicely done. All right. Now, thermal energy can move, okay, and go from one thing to the other in three different ways. In three different ways. Way number one, we'll come up here in a second. So I just have this little drawing of, that's a person holding a pot of water over the stove. That's a person holding a pot of water over the stove. Now, I didn't even bother trying to draw that because it would be way above my artistic pay grade. You will see some of my drawings later, especially my drawing of a foot. It's pretty pathetic. So, anyways, this is just for a little visual. Some people drew that. Other people didn't feel like they wanted to draw that. That's fine with me. Conduction is way number one. So conduction, that's when energy is transferred through matter to matter contact. Energy is transferred from matter to matter contact. Conduction. In other words, that's transfer of energy from particle to particle. These particles have to be touching. You actually have to touch, okay? So that's when energy is transferred because two things are physically touching each other. They have to be touching. Generally speaking, this will be happening with solids, most commonly. And we'll see an example of this in this little pot holder, where the energy is transferring from the base of this pot where it's hottest, and it's going this way through the handle. So the handle will get hotter as time goes on. And that's an example of conduction right there. That's an example of conduction right there. Now, way number two that energy can transfer. Convection. Convection. That's transfer of energy in a gas or a liquid. So the energy is transferring. It may not be because two things are touching, but if there's a gas or a liquid in between those two things, the energy can transfer that way. Sometimes people say it's by movement of currents or something like that. So we have a lot of extra thermal energy at the bottom of this pot, and it will travel through this water, move upwards through that liquid. So that's an example of your convection right there. Okay, the energy traveling through. Sort of a cyclical nature here. Most holidays and over the summer especially, I make beef jerky. It's really fun. It's one of my only hobbies. It's like beef jerky, basketball, and reading books. Those are like the only hobbies I have. But I use convection. So basically, I have like hot air, and it transfers heat throughout the whole little column like this and moves downward. And it's by convection because the energy is traveling through the air on that one. The little pieces of beef jerky are not actually touching each other. My cousin, he always shows up over Thanksgiving. We call it Meat Mountain. So we just get like a big pile of beef jerky. It's great. Unless you're vegetarian, then it's not so great. But for us, it's great. Anyways, last means is radiation. Radiation! You guys probably heard that before. Sometimes people just generally think it's like, that's a bad word. That means something bad. Radiation. Just doesn't sound safe, Mr. P. That's because a lot of the examples of radiation we're familiar with are not so great for human health. This is where electromagnetic waves that directly transport energy. Electromagnetic waves that directly transport energy. Electromagnetic waves, that's a fancy way to say the word light, basically. So that is when energy is transferred as light. The particles do not need to be there. So this is when energy can travel without going from particle to particle. It can just travel through space. So, for example, our sun. In between us and the sun is a lot of empty space where there just basically aren't any particles for that energy to travel through. So 99% of that journey from the sun to us, the energy is traveling via light in the form of, or it's traveling via radiation in the form of light. So it's not going from particle to particle, just coming towards us. And the moment it hits our atmosphere and has some gas particles to work with, then it's traveling through convection. But not until it gets to particles does it travel through convection. So most of that trip is radiation. Most of that trip is radiation. And there will be questions like that on like a quiz or test where we're like, hey, here's a situation, here's an example of energy being transferred. Is that conduction? Is that convection? Is that radiation? Talk to me. Yep. All right. So we talked about our lab yesterday. Their lab from yesterday. This is my perfect day at the end, if you guys kind of remember this. So we took some cold water, we took some hot water, we mixed them together, and the temperature sort of met in the middle. So first of all, when we found the difference between the hot and the mixed temperature, we called that difference yesterday, but we're going to call that delta T for now on. So what's the delta mean again? Change, right? That's the Greek letter delta. Means change. So the delta T is the change in temperature. You will see that all the time, the delta T of something. In fact, I'll just refer to it as the delta T. So across out the difference here and put delta T. But what we saw was, okay, so the hot was at 58 degrees Celsius. And when we mixed it with the cold, it was brought down to 40. So a delta T of 18 degrees. The cold was all the way down at 22 degrees Celsius. When we mixed it with hot water, it was brought up to 40. Its delta T was also 18. We're ignoring the negative. We just want to know how much it changed, not which direction for now. And so we saw that the delta T of the hot was equal to the delta T of the cold. Now, this only works for having equal masses of water. That's why we have to have the exact same volumes. And again, no, that's not delta thought. That's just the delta T of the hot. Okay. Here's the big idea that you wrote down at the end of the period yesterday. Energy lost by the hot is the energy gained by the cold. And that's where I was like, put a box around it. Start up. Highlight it. This is a big idea, big idea, big idea. The energy lost by the hot will always equal the exact same as the energy gained by the cold. Okay? Energy lost by the hot will always equal the exact same as the energy gained by the cold. This sound familiar to you guys at all? In any way? Does this remind you of anything from last unit, perhaps? Ooh, matter cannot be created or destroyed. Or what was sometimes what we'd write? We'd write mass before equals mass after. That's exactly where we're going, baby. The law of conservation of energy. I bet some of you guys could tell me exactly what this is about to say before I even reveal it. What is it going to say? Energy cannot be created or destroyed. You got it. Boom. Yeah, my brain worked good hard, Mr. P. I knew what was coming. Yeah, energy cannot be created or destroyed. It is impossible for energy to be created or destroyed. 10 billion years ago, whenever the universe was created, the amount of energy that particular moment was the exact same amount of energy in the universe today. And 10 billion years from now, that'll be the exact same amount of energy in the universe. Okay? Amount of energy in the universe cannot change Because the heat gained by one thing is always lost by something else and vice versa. So if anything ever gains heat that didn't just magically show up, that must have come from somewhere. If you ever lose heat, it's not like it just disappears and goes off into the stars. Well, I guess it could go into the stars, but it's not disappearing, okay? It must have gone somewhere. It must have gone somewhere. So this actually led to some pretty interesting discussion in class. Does anyone see, like, a problem with this idea? Like, okay, so energy can never be created or destroyed. That begs a certain question. If energy can't be created or destroyed, that begs a certain question. Yeah, or the idea of where did the energy come from in the first place? If it can't ever be created, then how do we even have it in the first place? So that was a really good discussion we had last period. So this is a really good point to make about the limits of science. I obviously love science, okay? I've dedicated my whole career to teaching people science because I like it so much. Now, science does have some limits. So last period, someone's like, oh, wait, does this mean this like disproves the Big Bang? Okay, so no, the Big Bang is the idea that all the mass and all the energy from the universe was in one infinitely small spot, okay, billions of years ago. And then it all exploded outward in one crazy moment, okay? And to this day, the mass and energy of the universe is slowly spreading, well, not even slowly, is spreading out, getting further and further away, okay? So some people are like, well, but where did that energy come from? Where did that mass come from? And the answer for in science terms is we don't know, okay? So that's where a lot of people, so science is the study of like natural law, natural cause and effect. And so that's where a lot of people say, well, there must be a supernatural, super means above, so above natural law, above cause and effect. There must be some sort of supernatural explanation for where energy and mass came from. Because science has no ability to explain what that is. So some people would be like, oh yeah, science can explain everything. It proves this, it proves that. Science doesn't prove anything, and it can't explain everything. It's just a good explanation. It's like, okay, we can explain some things with science. There's some things we really just have no explanation for because science is limited. Science is limited. So energy can't be created or destroyed at this point, but once upon a time, there must have been one moment where it was all created. And that, a lot of people would argue, that would have a supernatural cause of some kind. At least that's the best we can come up with for now. Now, don't forget that law of conservation of mass. Energy can't be created or destroyed, and neither can mass from unit 2. Mass cannot be created or destroyed. The mass of reactants equals the mass of the products. Or you say the mass before equals the mass after. You don't necessarily have to write down that in black. I just don't want you to forget, okay? I just don't want you to forget. Boom. Alrighty. So now that brings us to temperature. We've heard this word before lots of times. You talk about the temperature outside most days of your life. Temperature is actually the average kinetic energy of a particle, of the particles in a substance. It's an average. It's a ratio. Thermal energy is when you take the energy of all the particles and you add them up. It's a grand total. Temperature is just an average. Just an average, okay? So, for example, if I were to hold a thermometer up in this room, right now it's telling me the temperature of this room is like 22.3 degrees Celsius, apparently. Now, if Alyssa were to walk up and close that door over there and change the amount of air in this container, okay, we change the shape of the container, is this temperature really going to change? No, okay. This thermometer doesn't know how much air is in this room, right? It's just giving me the average temperature of the air around it. So temperature does not depend on how much stuff you have. It's just an average rating of the stuff nearby, okay? So temperature is just an average. Or if I were to take this thermometer and put it in a beaker, do you think the temperature is going to change right now? No, not really, even though it's just getting the temperature of the particles in a small container. So temperature is just an average. We're going to be talking about temperature in Celsius and Kelvin. Degrees Celsius and sometimes degrees Kelvin, mostly Celsius. Mr. P, how come there's not a degree symbol by the K? I don't know, there just isn't. So we just put K. We just put K. Mr. Pilcher, how do I go from Celsius to Kelvin? It's really easy. Take Celsius, whatever it is, slap 273 on it, and that's your Kelvin. So Kelvin's just 273 degrees ahead of Celsius. So if you're 0 degrees Celsius, you got 273 degrees Kelvin. If you're 100 degrees Celsius, you got 373 degrees Kelvin. Mr. Pilcher, why is that a thing? Why is that a thing? Well, it's all about reference point. So 0 degrees Celsius, that's where water freezes. 100 degrees Celsius, that's where water boils. And so some people are like, that is so crazy. What are the odds that water boils at exactly 100 and freezes at exactly 0? The odds are 100% because we decided that's what 0 and 100 are because that's where water freezes and that's where water boils. Okay? So 0 degrees Celsius is just a reference point. We decided to place the 0 on that number scale where water freezes. That's just what we decided. And anything below freezing water is below 0. Or anything above that is above 0. So Kelvin, all we did was we just moved where we wanted that 0 to be on the number line. So the 0 for Kelvin is absolute 0. And that is the idea of where particles stop moving altogether. This has never been shown to be possible. It's just a theoretical idea where you can get something at such a low temperature that the particles themselves stop moving. We've gotten really close. We've gotten in within less than 1 degree of Kelvin, of 0 degrees Kelvin, but we've never actually gotten to 0 Kelvin for anything, where the particles just straight up stop moving altogether. But theoretically, that's what would happen. Temperature is intensive. And why is it intensive? Someone explain that to me. How come temperature is intensive but thermal energy is extensive? What's the deal? Explain this to me, somebody. Why is temperature intensive? Parker?
Well, like you said, it's not the amount, it's the average of what you have. So if you add more, that just brings the average to around the same spot as it was before.
Right. So because temperature is about an average, it's a ratio, if you remove some of the sample you're looking at, it doesn't really change the average, really, okay? Unlike thermal energy, where every time you take away a sample, you're taking away particles which have kinetic energy and add into the grand total. Yep. Hey, this is a little scale. You guys don't have to write this one down, but just so you know. So melting or freezing point, boiling says condensation point. In Fahrenheit, that's 32 degrees and 212 degrees, okay? In Celsius, that's 0 and 100. And Kelvin, that's 273 and 373. By the way, your body temperature is 98 degrees, not Celsius. You'd be so dead if that was the case. Your body temperature is about 98. Falling apart. There we go. Your body temperature is about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, 37 degrees Celsius. And what would that be in Kelvin? Well, we got to take the Celsius and 273 to it. So let's see here. I think that would come out to be 310. Okay, so 98F, 37C, 310K, those are all the same thing. Those all mean the same thing, okay? Those are all the exact same temperature. Alrighty. Let's talk about heat. Alright, so what is heat? The transfer of energy from one substance to another. So when we're seeing that conduction, that convection, that radiation, we would refer to that as heat, because the energy is transferring from one place to another. It'll be in units of calories or joules. Calories like in my food? As a matter of fact, yes. We'll talk about that a lot more in the burning food lab, where we're lighting Cheetos and stuff on fire. Should be a good time. So that's just a little teaser for now. Because heat will normally be in the joules unit. Sometimes calories are. Always speak in the direction of heat, not the direction of cold. From here on out, I want you to consider the word cold a bad word. Don't say a bad word in my class, all right? Talk to me about heat. So I better not catch Izzy, okay, when she's in the hallways, like, oh my gosh, the cold was moving. Don't you dare, okay? Talk to me about heat and which direction heat's going, okay? She's like, why does he yell at me so much? Okay, talk to me about the direction of heat. So heat's going into this. Heat's coming out of that. Don't be like, the cold's going this way, the cold, no. Heat's going this way, heat's going that way. Heat is extensive because, again, it's just about the grand total. And you will be using the idea of heat on the test. Okay? And lots of times you'll be drawing little arrows to indicate heat going one way or the other on the test. Richard Pilcher, do I have to draw things to get like a good grade this unit? Absolutely not. But most people do. Most people find drawing the explanation easier than writing out the full sentences. And you'll get a feel for that when we do a practice problem here in a little bit. You're like, some people are like, oh, I'd rather write out the sentences. And other people are like, the picture was way easier for me. So that way, a lot of different types of learners can meet the needs of the question. Conductor. All a conductor is that's just something that easily transfers energy. That's all that is. That's all that is. Something that easily transfers energy. And an insulator is the opposite. It really resists energy being transferred. So sometimes we'll kind of think of conductors as fast transfer and insulators as slow. In both cases, energy will go through a conductor or an insulator, but it just may take a lot longer. So picture, who's got their driver's license already? None of you? Not yet? We're oh so close. You just turned 16 too, right? So you're on the cusp. All right, well, let's pretend that Workman's got his license back there. If Workman's on the highway, he's getting somewhere fast. He can also drive through neighborhoods the whole way to get there. And it's like, it's only 25 miles per hour. People are double parked. There's kids playing. So he'll still get to the same place, but it's going to take a lot longer. Okay? So the crowded neighborhood, that's sort of like an insulator, whereas a conductor is the highway. We're on the highway with the conductor. And those are terms you're going to have to drop to get your full credit on various quizzes and tests. Okay? Sort of like intensive and extensive. You had to actually say the word on your test. We're looking for that. All right. Let's talk about nature's tendency. And then we're going to start to see Mr. P's drawings. Heat goes from an area of high temps to low temp. In nature, whenever you have a high temp next to a low temp, which I'll represent by an H in the box and an L in the box, heat will always go from the high temp to the low temp. And again, some people are like, wait, why is that? Science doesn't have an answer for that. It's just simply, it is what it is. So we kind of go back to that Big Bang idea where the energy was in one spot, and now it's traveling outwards forever and ever. Same idea. Energy is just always going from the high temp to the low temp, and that's just how it works. We don't know why. All we're saying is what it is. So you'll see arrows like this. Okay, you'll draw lots of times. You'll have a little H with a box around it and have a big arrow always pointing towards the L. I'm always going towards a big L in your class, Mr. P, and that was true before we started Thermochem. Oh my gosh. Oh, my jokes are so good. Okay. So coldness does not exist. Do not talk to me about coldness. Talk to me about a lack of heat or a relatively low temperature. But don't talk to me about coldness. No. No, 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 no. Lack of heat. All right. Mr. Pilcher, drawing time. Now, to be fair, I spent several minutes on these drawings, so they're a little bit better than they normally would be. And you'll see that when you see my foot. Here we go. So I got a little guy on the left. He's 37 degrees Celsius, because that's body temp. Outside is 0 degrees, so this is wintertime. And here's a little house, a little smokestack. Look at that. Got my little square with the triangle on top house. Pretty good, right? Now, that's the top of my, this is like the tippy top of my art game. Like, that is as good as it's going to get. So anyways... Some people are like, they walk outside, they got the fancy jeans with the holes, and I'm like, oh, the cold is going to my knee! Okay? That's not what's happening. That's not what's happening. You are the relatively high temperature, aren't you? I would hope so, unless you're dead, okay? If it's 0 degrees outside, that wouldn't be great if you're 0 degrees. You'll get hypothermia if you get, like, to 35 degrees. So that's not what we're looking for. The low temperature of outside. So which direction will heat always go? From high to low. And so the cold is not going into your jeans, the hole in your jeans. It's leaving. Heat is leaving through the holes in your jeans. Some people are like, wait, do you have like jeans on your face? And I'm just saying, like, the heat is trying to sprint out of your body the moment you walk outside. And it can do so much more easily if there's a hole in your jeans. All right, anyone want to drive their parents nuts? Has anyone had this happen? It's winter time. You leave the door open. Your dad's like, "Bloody! You're letting the cold in! Shut that door!" Okay, you know what you could say? You know what you could say? "Well, actually, Dad, cold's not coming in because, he always goes from high to low temperatures, so technically speaking, heat's going out." He'd be like, "Great! Go to your room anyways, alright?" So, when you have your relatively high temperature house, you have a low temperature outside, cold is not coming into that house, but there is heat leaving. It's sprinting out of your house the moment it opens the door. Cold, you know how, like, if you guys have a dog and they're in, like, the crate, okay, and they're just constantly looking for a way to get out the crate, and the moment the door is open, they're out, just like that. Heat is like that in your house. Like, it is constantly smashing up against the walls and windows, like, "Please, let me out of here," when it's in the wintertime. And the moment it has an opportunity to sprint out, it will, okay? So, like, every single, you can't train the heat, like, "Stay, sit." Like, no, that's not how that works with heat. Like, heat will just sprint out the door every time there's an opportunity. That's how it works. That's how it works. So, let's try one thing real quick for me. Take your paw and grab the metal leg of your chair. Okay? Now take your paw and grab the wooden leg of your table. And what are you observing? Well, you're observing that, quote-unquote, the metal chair feels cold and that the wood feels warmer. Is that about right? Like, the metal chair feels colder? Okay? Now, here's what people think. Oh, well, they must be at different temperatures, right? The chair must be at a lower temperature than the table. That's not true. They've both been sitting in this room the whole time. It's not like I had, like, a little heater on, like, the wood of leg of all of your tables secretly, okay? They're the exact same temperature. So, nope, both at room temp. So why does the metal chair feel colder? It's a conductor. That's true, but what does that mean? That means the energy, the heat, will leave my hand faster. So if you hold them both for a really long time, they'll feel about the same. But when you first touch the leg of that metal chair, the heat leaves immediately. It's sprinting out of your hand, whereas it's sort of slowly waltzing into the wooden leg of the table. So the metal is a conductor and the wood is an insulator. Which direction is energy being transferred in both cases? The energy is going from what to what? Your hand to either the leg of the chair or the leg of the table. So the direction of heat is not different. It's just how quickly is it happening. So, for example, if I were to draw this, okay, here's my little Mickey Mouse glove. That's your paw. Okay, here you go. Your paw is a relatively high temperature. Chair leg, relatively low temperature. Table leg, relatively low temperature. Heat goes from here to here. Heat goes from here to here. Notice how nothing is different yet? Okay? The only thing that becomes different now is that this is slow. And so there's lots of times you can just write that on top of the arrow, like, "Hey, it's going slow." Whereas here, this is fast. And then you might want to label this, like, conductor. I'll shorten it here because I'm kind of running out of space. Insulator. Something like that. That is a way that you can probably get some full credit on a test question. Now, this is us. We're going to practice this worksheet. That's my drawing of a foot. We'll talk about that later. But, yeah, so we're going to go ahead and do some practice. So go ahead and pause the video if you're watching from home. Spend some time working on this, and we'll talk about a couple problems at the end. Okay, you've had a few minutes. Let's talk about this problem right here. Mr. P, will you be grading artistic ability? Absolutely not. I couldn't think of anything more hypocritical if I took off points because your art's not great. All you need to do is you need to make it clear to me. So you might just have to make labels. So, like, for example, if you look at my foot and then you, like, cover up half of this mat, that also looks like my version of a foot, okay? So that's why I put, this is a mat. This is a foot. So that way Mr. P won't get confused. So as long as it's really clear what's what, and some of you guys don't have to label the tiles because I can totally tell. So here's the situation. My foot is a relatively high temperature. The mat is relatively low. And so is the tile because they're at room temperature. which is a lot lower than body temperature. Body temperature is hanging around 37 degrees Celsius. Room temperature is in the low to mid 20s. Okay. So energy for my foot will be going to the mat. It will also be going to the tile, but with the tile, it's fast, and the mat, it's slow. So why is it slow with the mat? Well, it must be an insulator, resist energy transfer. Whereas the tile, it must be a conductor, because energy transfers easily. This person, if this was your answer, they do not have any full sentences. They don't even have like bullet points or number lists. They just have some really good labeling with their drawings. This would be a full credit answer. Like, this could be like 6, 7, 8 point question on a test. You could get full credit for this because I'm like, look, they used the terms I had to see. I had to see insulator. I had to see conductor. I know which direction the energy is going. I know it's got the high and the low temperature. I know that this one's going slowly. This one's going fast. Like, they're making it so clear. Look, the energy goes slowly into this one because it's an insulator and it slows that down. The energy is going quickly into the conductor because it allows allows energy to transfer quickly. So this would be like a perfect response. Now, some of you guys wrote full sentences, and that is perfectly fine. I'll read every single word what you write down on a quiz or test. But a lot of people find this is a lot easier, and it's a better way for them to explain themselves. Okay? So that is that for today. Pretty long video, but tomorrow we'll be having fun doing the chemistry and Ziploc lab.